Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Invoke the Goddess, Connecting to the Hindu, Greek, and Egyptian Deities, revised and updated edition, by Kala Trobe. Narrated by Siiri Scott. Introduction. Invoke the Goddess is a magical workbook. It is designed to enable the reader to access and channel specific goddess wavelengths. By interacting with these deities and maintaining a strong inner will, it becomes possible to gain blessings and insight, to influence the psychic space in which we exist, and thus to alter personal circumstance. With the goal of individual gnosis in mind, and in order to attain specific, practical results, five goddesses have been selected from each of three major religious backgrounds: Hindu, Egyptian, and Greek. The exercises and visualizations allow one to access these deities on a personally interactive as well as a cosmic level. Each goddess offers properties and experiences applicable to our physical, emotional, and spiritual lives. That positive visualization can bring positive results is a fact widely heralded and an underlying principle of this book. However, the visualization processes described within are no mere placebos. The god forms involved are intelligent entities, and interaction with them may take place in what seems to be the imagination, but it is not imaginary. As anyone who has practiced such meditations and bhaktis will confirm, the deities, whether they start on the earth plane as statues, images, symbols, or focused thoughts, very soon take on a life of their own, and the results inevitably filter down to the material planes. Equally real is the effect of these encounters on one's psychology. The visualizations lead the participant into a direct encounter with a powerful archetypal deity, whose symbols and presence will make a profound impression on the subconscious, stimulating one's innate capacity for self-healing and self-development. The same applies to the visualizations for specific goals, such as acquiring a long-term partner or attaining prosperity. Not only does a seeker appeal to a relevant deity, but one's higher self is brought into action, aiding that process. The gods help those who help themselves. Also included are exercises designed to help seekers delve in a controlled manner into the murkier areas of their psyche and, with the aid of a divinity, bring conflicting currents to check, or, even better, to harness these disturbances and negative experiences as a creative and evolutionary energy source. These qualities are particularly available through the more challenging goddesses such as Kali, Sekhmet, and aspects of Hecate. Sometimes, it becomes crucial to look into the painful darkness of our own fears and faults before we can experience a trusting deliverance into the light. These inner journeys are described step by step as far as is possible without subjecting the psychic voyager to a contrived experience. Room has been left for personal extrapolation, while every effort has been made to aid creative thinking and to provide enough signposts to keep the seeker on the right path. However, preset routes are by their nature far from definitive, and seekers are encouraged to use their own judgment and interpret them accordingly. Personal encounters are always more relevant than second-hand knowledge, though the latter is helpful in guiding us to the relevant area of the universal psyche. These experiences are, after all, archetypal, and subsequently, par sculpted by all who have undergone them. Because such a clear subconscious map exists in our astral and etheric DNA, it is very safe to use one's intuition in these exercises. In doing so, one is accessing wisdom far greater than that normally made available to us. These exercises are intended to create intense and transformative states in the user. Their aim is predominantly healing and magical elevation, enhancement of quality of life, and reconnection with spiritual source. How to perform the visualizations. There are several ways to approach these visualizations. Many of the exercises are performed by candlelight and involve meditative states, and some readers may prefer a ritualistic approach. But this by no means excludes the possibility of simply visualizing while listening to the exercises. Indeed, this can be very powerful, particularly if done in a state of heightened emotion. Additionally, every chapter begins with a section of poetic prose specifically designed to stimulate the imagination and open it out toward that particular goddess. For some, focused reading alone will be enough to set the magic rolling. A few years ago, for example, I heard from a man who declared himself a former cynic, now converted to a wider awareness. Invoke the Goddess, in its original form, had landed in his vicinity via a family member at a time when he was due to interview for a job he particularly wanted, and it caught his eye. Considering nothing ventured, nothing gained, he decided to try a new approach. After consulting the index of goddess functions, he went to the Lakshmi section and found the exercise most appropriate to his cause, for spiritual and material well-being. In a quiet space, he cleared his mind and, in his own time, went through the mental processes described. Unversed in any yogic practices and not keen on candles, incense, or mantras, he simply focused and strongly visualized whilst reading the text. A suitable state thus attained, I am thrilled to say he got and kept the job. The moral of this story is to do what feels best for you and do it your own way. I, too, have often had powerful experiences while simply reading and strongly imagining rituals or magical techniques, often also by writing them down. A great deal can be achieved on the astral, spiritual planes while the body remains relatively immobile, a principle that underlines all of these visualizations. We each have our favorite approaches to supplication and worship with its many ramifications, some active and demonstrative, while others may find gestures, chanting aloud and so on, to be distracting. This book provides for all attitudes and gives ideas rather than rules. If you prefer not to punctuate your meditation by referring to the book, one option is to familiarize yourself with the root beforehand. Memorize the major symbols or make bullet point notes and capture the essence of the goddess by listening to the sections describing her personality and functions. Once you have committed the exercise to memory or summed it up handily, you should be able to perform it while in a relaxed, meditative state. Another possibility is to have a friend or partner read the exercise aloud while you visualize it. This can also be done in group situations, with one person reading and the rest taking the inner journey. This, of course, has the added advantage of enabling participants to exchange experiences and information afterward, if so desired. Finally, you could record yourself reading the exercise and leave suitable space to accomplish the various stages of the meditation. This allows you to be absolutely relaxed when the visualization is performed and drift off into inner space with no holds barred. A couple of attempts at this will enable you to assess your time requirements at each stage. Like every living thing, whether apparently so or not, think trees, rivers, mineral formations. God and goddess forms are intelligent patterns of energy, albeit particularly refined and powerful ones. They are entities full of personality and sacredness, perhaps elevated into a prolonged and enhanced existence by the intense and continual input of other beings, perhaps entirely independent. Some developed from and provided the atavistic necessities of the species, such as light and warmth, solar and fire deities, and food, gods of hunting and harvest. Others have brought forth and grown from civilization, such as gods of intellect and artistry. Myth attempts to project our inner reality onto a cosmic screen, as well as to describe the nature of our arrival at consciousness. Not only are the gods and goddesses at large on the astral and spiritual causal planes, they are also in our very midst every day. I do not mean courtesy of psychic perception alone, but as psychological archetypes alive in us all in some shape, form, or mixture, usually the latter. As many a witch or spiritual psychologist knows, it is great fun to spot the ancient ones wandering through our lives in an often quite blatant manner as nomadic archetypes, and these can provide us with valuable psychotherapeutic clues as to our nature and needs. More and more of the god forms are making themselves known in this manner. The age-old constellations of consciousness are comprehensively spangling our inner space. The rise in popularity over the last decades of many ancient pantheons reflects a modern need to reclaim personal interaction with both the natural world and the divine. It expresses a global desire for deities of specific function and form unavailable in most orthodox religions. No longer is a clerical intercessor required to create or sanctify one's connection with Source. A huge advantage of the current Occidental era is that the goddess has now become personal. Of course, in some venerable religions such as Hinduism, particularly Advaita, this has long been the case, with the divine, by its very nature, being everywhere, rather than made manifest exclusively inside a human-made building or via a ministry in a pre-approved context. In general, however, independent spirituality has been anathema. It is a huge privilege to be present in a time and place in which personal mystical experience within the belief system of one's own choice is possible, legal, and no longer unusual. Channeling and/or interacting with the divine has consequently never been freer or more socially acceptable. That being said, I am a firm believer in discretion when discussing or revealing one's personal spirituality and magics. With so much dependent on the perceptions and preconceived notions of the listener, an authentic experience can easily be sullied by their doubt, disbelief, envy, or even laughter. Casually talking of, or portentously announcing, even small psychic interactions can provoke misunderstanding, prideful self-delusion, and apparent boastfulness, and is likely to dissipate the positive import and authenticity of the interaction. Hearken ye well unto the powers of the Sphinx, to know, to will, to dare, and to keep silent. The practitioner may benefit from attunement to astrological specifics when deciding when to perform the visualizations, or by picking a day or date that relates to that deity to aid the vibrations, although this is not a necessity. Moon phases are key to any spell and will likely prove relevant. Seasons and their flora and symbols are also referenced alongside the exercises where significant. Keeping a fast prior to the visualizations is a bonus, as is restraint from any negative indulgences. The eating of meat is anathema to most spiritual practices for numerous reasons. Please bear in mind which deities you are dealing with. It would be vile, for example, to approach a Hindu god or goddess to whom the cow, gu, is most sacred, with beef on your breath or in your gut. Likewise, it would be counterintuitive to approach those bastions of justice and temperance, Ma'at or Iris, while tipsy or high. Common sense awareness should allow you to deduce these important aspects of courtesy and taboo. Washing before ritual is of huge benefit. See the next section. All of this being said, the most essential factors are an open heart and mind. Once your celestial interchange has been established, thank the goddess and offer gifts as seems apt to you. A flame, incense, a flower, or more elaborate offerings. Afterward, allow the deity to depart before you do. Otherwise, just go with the sacred flow. Ritual baths. Ritual baths or lustrations are an excellent preliminary to any magical endeavor, creating a suitable atmosphere and relaxing body and mind alike. It is traditional, of course, to make ablutions before worship and ritual in almost all cultures. Modern takes on this theme range from simple salt baths to elaborate psychic consommés, and a recipe appropriate to the individual goddess is given prior to most of the meditations. In addition to the herbs and essential oils traditionally used in bathing waters, gemstones may be added to cold water and left for a while to imbue it with their specific qualities. Rose quartz, for example, exudes positive, compassionate properties that are of great use when dealing with hurt feelings and the cosmic chill of lack of faith. A quantity may be left to soak in water, and the water then poured into the bath in conjunction with rose oil and perhaps some pink solarized or aura soma style water. The person who steps into this bath is unlikely to remain unhappy for long. Color-treated water is particularly good to use in the ritual bath. It strengthens chakras and aids with visualizing them. However, use natural dyes from flowers, spices, herbs, and barks, and in moderation so as not to tint or irritate the skin. Never use chemical colorings. Alternatively, you can simply visualize the color suffusing the water before you step into it. Candles around the bathtub also create a wonderful ambiance. Their colors may be chosen with a specific aim or chakra area in mind. A brief guide to color usage. Red, strength, determination, passion, sex. Yellow, emotional healing, health, financial prosperity, intellect. Orange, vitality, happiness, antidepressive. Green, new beginnings, balance, growth, fertility, financial prosperity. Pale pink, comfort, love, affection, heart mender. Dark pink, fun, challenge, adventure, feisty frolickings, sex, beauty. Blue, calming, inspiring, poetic inspiration. Violet, spirituality, inner vision, psychic development. Purple, akasha, deep spiritual knowledge. high ritual, spiritual, physical, and or emotional self-sacrifice. Black, self-protection, attack, vengeance, curse-making and breaking, powerful psychological changes. Turquoise, self-defense, both psychic and physical, attunement to the cosmic will in action. Chakras. There are many detailed books, as well as free online articles and lectures, on the complex subject of auras and chakras. The newcomer is advised to purchase or watch one. Opinions vary as to some chakric associations and properties, largely due to the conflict between traditional Hindu-Buddhist symbolism and modern interpretations of the chakras. For the sake of clarity, in this book I have adhered to the westernized version, which allies the chakras with the colors of the spectrum and makes them simple and effective to visualize. However, the arcane symbols and colors may be of more relevance to some readers. It is good to experiment in both schools of thought in order to deepen understanding and to find which feels best for you. A chart or banner depicting the chakras in order will provide an invaluable mental map of the psychic bodies. Keeping one in the room in which you meditate can be very useful. The Sanskrit word chakra means wheel or discus and indicates the shape of the energy points known by that name. Hindu deities are often depicted clasping a serrated one as a formidable weapon of spiritual and physical power. Within each of us, these discs of colored light are spiritual and emotional energy centers to the physical and etheric bodies, and their condition tells much about their owner's state of emotional, spiritual, and even physical well-being, the three frequently being connected. They are, in many respects, the digestive system of the soul, the part of the constitution that takes sustenance from the cosmos and specific spiritual sources and makes it usable to the individual. Just as DNA carries the genetic code of physical lineage and the psychophysical blueprint of the vessel of flesh, the chakras record the subtler patterns of our lives, thoughts, deeds, and all that is emotional or high level. The soul's chakric structure, aka its astral form, works with the materials available to create the physical body, and as much as is possible, the circumstances most fitting for the inhabiting soul's next set of lessons and experiences. As each chakra relates to a separate part of the body, set of glands, hormones, and psycho-spiritual function, it follows that its speed, depth of color, condition, and psychic appendages are indicative. These may be perceived by observation through the third eye or ajna chakra itself, or in whatever other way one receives intuitive information. For example, a cardiac complaint might be visible in the heart chakra as a rift or murky coloring at the center. Or the person focusing on it might sense a density of energy. Most likely, it will have an emotional and spiritual origin that is also visible to psychic vision. Such manifestations are, of course, as various as their perceivers and subjects, but, as with the visualizations themselves, certain symbols are universal. A broken heart could manifest as savaged auric fiber or bruised or bloody coloring, while unwillingness to love for fear of rejection may be apparent as an armored area in the chest or a small, tight box. We see here the root of psychosomatic illness. Emotional problems stored in the aura overlap and infect the relevant part of the physical body. The emotional grievance of a broken heart subsequently disrupts the material health of the body and can bring about a cardiac condition. For those of a sensitive constitution, it is all too easy to literally die of a broken heart, and not just for love. All sorts of anxieties and disappointments may be responsible. Clearly, the maintenance of a healthy astral body, chakras included, is of paramount importance to total well-being. Chakras are also the generators of the aura, the glowing body sheath of sometimes visible energy. By maintaining and conditioning them, we influence every aspect of our manifestation and its well-being. There are 7 major chakras in the human body. They are, in descending order, crown, third eye, throat, heart, solar plexus, intestinal, and root. Each relates to a particular gland: pineal, pituitary, thyroid and parathyroid, thymus, pancreas, adrenal, and reproductive, respectively. Each also performs specialized functions and are indicated in the next section. The Sanskrit name and associated gland are noted. Crown, Sahasrara, pineal. The crown chakra is located at the center of the top of the skull. It is a major inlet for prana, the universal life energy. This is the chakra most relevant to spiritual matters, and its Sanskrit title translates as thousand-petaled, the lotus of perfection in meditative symbolism. It is an indication of the soul's essential purity that its color is an effulgent white. Third eye, ajna, pineal, pituitary. Located between and slightly above the eyebrows in the bindi position, this is the center of inner vision, intuition, and innovative ability. The ajna is the third eye of psychic and spiritual insight. Through this chakra, we access akashic information, the contents of the cosmic library or universal subconscious. Its color is purple. Throat, Vishuddha, thyroid. Connected with communication, spiritual guidance, and the ability to listen and hear, this is an important people skills chakra. It is pertinent to the endocrine and thyroid glands. It is sky blue or white and located in the middle back of the throat and should ideally be felt to vibrate when chanting. Meaning pure, purification, an emphasis is apparent on speaking and propagating both truth and goodwill. Heart, anahata, thymus. This is the green zone in the center of the sternum. Its position allies it to the pulmonary as well as cardiac functions. Meaning unstained, the anahata is the open and innocent part of us all, the essential purity of mind and soul, unbroken by doubt, pain, cynicism, and negative emotions. It is strongly associated with the faculty of hope and is the emotional center regarding love ties, particularly those of an innocent or aspirational nature. From the heart chakra, extend the astral etheric cords that connect the individual, karmically and emotionally, to relevant people and places, covering many time spans. Consequently, it is possible to use these cords to trace, for example, a soul-bonded partner from a former incarnation, or to employ them as telepathic communication cables. The properties of this chakra are so extensive, covering literally the entire body, that it becomes clear why the proper functioning of the psychophysical organism requires affection and love, and why the pursuit of it consumes so much of our time on Earth. Solar plexus, Manipura, pancreas, liver. Located a few inches below the heart chakra, in the soft tissue at the bottom of the ribcage, is the yellow solar plexus chakra. This zone is intimately connected with feelings, emotions, and gut reactions, and is often the real cause of gastrointestinal discomfort and conditions such as IBS in times of nervousness and stress. Like the heart chakra, the solar plexus is also a center for telepathic and empathetic communication. The cords that extend from it are representative of one's interaction with other entities, their thickness, depending on how frequent the contact has been, and the level of its impact. Unfortunately, these ties bind us just as tightly to people we hate as to people we love, sometimes more so. There is no better way to build up a lasting psychic rapport with someone than to feel strongly about them, either positively or negatively. Conversely, the best way to avoid being bound with another is to block them from your mind and render them irrelevant from the start, though this can be extremely hard to manage when one feels angry, insulted, rejected, endangered, or any of the plethora of emotions that blight most of us from time to time. There is more to the advice, turn the other cheek, that is, fail to react, than straightforward pacifism. Hurt feelings blur our judgment and can wreak havoc. Allowing oneself the chance to calm down, chant a mantra, and regain perspective before reacting is always wise, though all too often impossible. No wonder so many yogis and mystics live alone in forests and caves. If it can be attained, ignorance really is the best form of defense. No unnecessary interaction, no hindrance to one's spiritual ascent. The cords connecting us with people and places of little personal significance are, of course, the thinnest and most difficult to trace. The Manipura Center is also connected with morality issues, worldly ambition, and vice. Intestinal. Svarishtana. Adrenal. This orange spinning disc is connected with our faculty of interpretation, as well as with digestive and endocrinal functions. Body fluids are controlled from this zone, as are charisma and vitality levels. It therefore affects our ability and desire to interact with others. The intestinal chakra lies halfway down the stomach, between the navel and genitals. Root. Root. Muladhara, testes, or ovaries. The red base chakra relates to sexuality, connection to earth, and instinctive feelings, such as fear in life-threatening situations. If we have a purely sexual relationship with someone, they will be connected to us primarily through this chakra, although purely sexual relationships are in fact very rare, being more of a function of incomplexity than our spiritual constitutions will normally allow. The intestinal and base chakras share the function of sustaining our physical response to sex, though all of the chakras have an influence in one way or another on our proper response to psychosexual stimuli. The immune system and basic survival modes are also controlled by the root energy center. Chants and mantras. We are blessed by Hinduism and Buddhism, especially with a wealth of ancient, scientific mantras immaculately attuned to each individual deity. Indeed, Sanskrit words and intonations are deemed to be god forms in and of themselves. Thanks to the complementary wonders of the modern world, these spiritual formulae are now accessible online, along with translations, correct intonation, pronunciation, and so on. This is the most incredible asset to the spiritual seeker. Of course, different strokes for different folks, but the reader is encouraged to access and practice these chants as their intelligence and intuition dictates. To japa, chant reverently, with a mala, prayer beads with which to count the repetitions, usually to 108, or even silently and entirely immobile, is one of the easiest means of shedding ego and gaining spiritual insight. It soon becomes evident that the syllables, sounds, and words are indeed living entities, and that the deities concerned abide within these mantras and are activated by their repetition. The neurological as well as spiritual effects of this simple tool are nothing short of mind-blowing, and the listener is encouraged to delve further. For our purposes here, relevant mantras may be found at the end of the initial descriptive passage on each Hindu goddess. Aum, Om. The Sanskrit word Aum is spelled Om, but properly pronounced Aum. Meditation on it prior to any and all of these exercises will help immensely. This syllable embodies being and not being. It is ultra-reality in the form of sound. For meditative purposes, it is usually intoned au as in home, higher pitched, u as in moon, slightly lower, preceded by an emphatic m, lower pitched still. These syllables represent the cosmic processes of creation, Brahma, preservation, Vishnu, and dissolution, Shiva, and contain all that is possible to be created, done, thought, and believed, and arguably plenty more besides. Sanskrit and mantra are mediated by Sarasvati, who gives musical and linguistic form to concept. Sometimes it is preferable to make the Aum sound aloud, vibrating it from your lower throat upward, with the final part at the front of the mouth. It is good to vibrate it wholly while running it up and down your spine and through your chakras, but this depends on circumstances and levels of privacy. Obviously, inhibition does not aid inner tranquility. A good alternative or supplement to chanting out loud is provided by the many excellent recordings of Hindu and Tibetan mantras now widely available. There are some superb samples on YouTube, for example. The dramatic atmospherics can thus be absorbed privately on headphones. The sometimes rather alarming-sounding ceremonies of Tibetan monks especially contain an extremely high dosage of Aum, and are excellent for helping evoke the sound in one's head. Once you are familiar with the mantras, it is possible and often desirable to chant them mentally, whether using a mala, asanas, a musical instrument, or without movement. Index of Goddess Functions. Purpose, Goddess. Purpose, abuse, coping with. Goddess, Kali. Purpose, amends making. Goddess, Nephthys. Purpose, athletics. Goddess, Artemis. Purpose, attraction of a sexual partner, Aphrodite. Attraction of a long-term partner, Radha and Isis. Attraction of money, Lakshmi. Purpose, balance. Goddess, Ma'at, Iris. Purpose, beauty. Goddess, Aphrodite, Isis. Purpose, body shape, changing. Goddess, Artemis, Sekhmet. Purpose, chakras conditioning. Goddess, Isis. Purpose, change. Accepting, Persephone. Change encouraging, Sarasvati. Purpose, coming out as gay, trans, or other. Goddess, Durga. Hecate. Purpose, communication skills. Goddess, Iris. Purpose, complacency, status quo. Challenging, Kali. Complacency, status quo attaining, Hathor, Lakshmi. Purpose, confidence, Goddess, Durga, Kali. Purpose, creativity, Goddess, Sarasvati. Purpose, depression combating, Goddess, Persephone, Sarasvati. Purpose, desire, Goddess, Aphrodite. Purpose, diplomacy, Goddess, Iris. Purpose, discrimination, combating, Goddess, Hecate, Ma'at. Purpose, divination, Goddess, Isis. Purpose, endurance, Goddess, Hathor, Artemis. Purpose, exam performance, Goddess, Sarasvati. Purpose, exercising the past, Goddess, Kali, Persephone, Radha. Purpose, faithfulness, Goddess, Isis. Purpose, fertility, Goddess, Hathor, Isis, Lakshmi. Purpose, friendship, creating against the odds, Goddess, Hecate. Purpose, gender fluidity, Goddess, Artemis. Purpose, getting even, Goddess, Durga, Hecate, Kali, Ma'at. Purpose, growth, Goddess, Hathor. Purpose, happiness, Goddess, Lakshmi. Purpose, healing, Goddess, Isis, Nephthys, Sarasvati. Purpose, inspiration, Goddess, Sarasvati, Isis. Purpose, integration, Goddess, Hecate, Iris. Purpose, intuition, Goddess, Isis. Purpose, justice, Goddess, Hecate, Ma'at, Iris. Purpose, love, attaining long-term, Goddess, Isis. Love, attaining sexual, Goddess, Aphrodite. Love, letting go temporarily, Goddess, Radha. Love, letting go permanently, Goddess, Radha. Purpose, magical ability, Goddess, Isis. Purpose, money, Goddess, Lakshmi. Purpose, nurturing, Goddess, Hathor. Purpose, phobias, overcoming, Goddess, Kali. Purpose, physical fitness, Goddess, Artemis. Purpose, prejudice, overcoming, Goddess, Hecate. Purpose, psychism, Goddess, Hecate, Isis. Purpose, separation, coping with or causing, Goddess, Radha. Purpose, sexuality, Goddess, Aphrodite. Purpose, shamanism, Goddess, Sekhmet. Purpose, shape-shifting, Goddess, Sekhmet, Artemis, Isis. Purpose, strength, emotional, Goddess, Durga, Kali. Strength, physical, Goddess, Artemis. Purpose, stuck in the mud, escaping, Goddess, Sarasvati. Purpose, study, Goddess, Sarasvati. Purpose, success, Goddess, Lakshmi. Purpose, truth, Goddess, Ma'at. Purpose, weight gain, loss, Goddess, Artemis. Purpose, wisdom, Goddess, Hecate, Ma'at, Sarasvati. Purpose, witchcraft skills, Goddess, Hecate, Isis, Persephone, Sekhmet. Part 1. Hindu Goddesses. Chapter 1. Sarasvati. Usually she can be found by the sacred river's edge, or floating on her lotus, her black hair flowing down a moon-white sari, the air alive with the mellifluous music of her veena. Sarasvati's fingers on the strings cause golden ages to arise, and when she ceases from her craft, civilizations fall, and the universe is diminished. She sits in mantric meditation, a crescent moon upon her forehead, Bindi of light, drawing deities from her potent spoken spells. She crafts the notes into yantras, geometric shapes infused with Vedic energy. These she may give as rewards to her favorite poets, sages, and winsome minstrels wandering lost in the world of delusion, of Maya. She will dip her admirers in the river of despair, blacker even than her pure black hair, or make them dance, spinning into the mire. Then unhungs, the pure white swan of infinite transcendence, she will glide to them, offering gifts. A searing draft of inspiration to unclog the blocked channel, a suddenly discovered talent to the sensitive, whose skills seemed useless, an iron will unto the genius, whose mind kept slipping sideways, downward into matter, undisciplined. Thus, she will hone her devotees to perfection once they have been baptized in her eternal waters. Silver as moonlight she glides, a breath of fragrant hope floating above the tumultuous depths of ignorance. Her gifts of speech, culture, and religious quest the rafts of our religious transiting. Look, beyond the river sits a gleaming city of many marvels, Sarasvati's citadel of astral gold, as yet uninhabited. A populace big enough to fill it must first brave the treacherous waters, following the muse, and utopia will be theirs. In the meantime, bards may sing and others dream of her promise, elevating thought and art. With every aspiration moving one step closer to fulfillment of Sarasvati's gifts and of the soul's sublime potential. Aum Rim Aim Krim Sarasvati Deviya Namaha. Sarasvati is one of the Tridev, or Holy Trinity of Goddesses, in Hinduism, along with Lakshmi and Parvati. She is goddess of supreme wisdom, knowledge, language, and the arts. In some scriptures, she appears as a female counterpart or Shakti of Vishnu, along with his wife Lakshmi. In other versions, she is wife of Brahma, god of creation, sometimes his daughter, and occasionally both. According to the Machu Puran, for example, Brahma creates Sarasvati as he meditates upon pure goodness, doing this in different descriptions, from his mouth, navel, or seminal fluid. The new goddess is so effulgently beautiful that he soon falls in love with her. Anxious to escape his amorous advances, the modest Sarasvati positions herself out of his direct gaze. In order to view his creation, Brahma creates another face. Sarasvati moves, and again, Brahma generates new features with which to appreciate his daughter, eventually totaling 5. At this point, Sarasvati flees to Shiva for protection. He promptly sovers Brahma by tearing off his topmost, or 5th, head, representative of the ego. Contrite, Brahma resolves to bless his daughter instead of pursuing her, giving her the free-flowing assets of a river with the ability to irrigate the minds and souls of men, bestowing her with the ability to gift speech to mankind, and finally, having her reside within his very form, so that he might never stultify and always learn more. At times, Sarasvati is paired with Ganesha, or with a local god pertaining to the arts. Considering the great antiquity of Hinduism, its primary dissemination by Shruti, or spoken word, and its spread over a vast continent, as well as to other countries, disparities are not surprising. However, she is usually depicted alone, happily independent, belonging to no individual, just as the arts themselves belong not to their creator so much as to humanity itself. Sarasvati's name means fluid or flowing, as is water that can be river or lake or rain, as is a spirit when joyful to be part of the universe, imaginative and inspired, as is good music, poetry, inspiration itself. She is also known as vach, or speech. Sarasvati offers the tools by which to reflect upon and thus understand one's human nature, and its ultimate truth: all is connected, and we are, without exception, each part of the.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.